Aloha, folks. It's Antonio, hypnosisproductreviews.com. Today I've got my guest, stage hypnotist Anthony Cools from Las Vegas. How you doing, Anthony?
Living the dream.
Okay, everybody, I'm going to give you a heads up. Most of my podcasts have been very PC and very clean. This is going to probably be very dirty and gratuitous uses of the words like piss, things like that. So turn away now.
Why are you going to do that? Why do you have to do that?
To give him a heads up.
No. Why are you gonna curse so much? You don't have to curse so much. Jeez, dude, it's crazy. Are you gonna offend me?
Okay, I don't think I can offend you after watching you in your stage show. I think I was in Hypno Thoughts last year. Saw you one night, and then the next night, Kevin Lapine was like, "Come on, we all got to go to the show." Apparently, he said you guys were hanging out with a bunch of lesbians afterwards. I'm sure it was a rough career.
We call that Thursday.
You call that Thursday. What's Wednesday?
Wednesday's a day off. That's the day of God, in my opinion. So, no. Actually, Wednesdays is just a day off, dude. that's the nice thing about being in Vegas and not having to tour. You know, I mean, I get a chance to go home every night. So when I walk off that stage, I'm off that stage. I'm not working anymore.
So you're not having to deal with the whole deal of the road and getting worn out.
No, well, not only that, but like the character I play up on stage is that exactly that. It's a character, you know. Like I rarely cuss off stage, to be honest with you. Like, I mean, I only use it in context. And like, I'm a normal guy. Like I just play this character up on stage, you know. I mean, that's what Vegas wants, so that's what Vegas is going to get.
Okay, well, except for the shirt that says cock, right?
Well, this is what I wear on Wednesdays around the house. Yeah.
It's the Wednesday shirt.
This is a tribute to roosters everywhere.
Yeah, speaking of, you ever been in Hawaii before?
I have never been, and I really want to go. I seriously, I'm thinking about going in December when I got my vacation. What's the weather like there in December? Is it nice?
It rains a little bit, but even if it rains, well, actually, do you even know what rain is? I know you guys don't get too much of it.
Rain. That's the old nightclub at the Palms.
Close. It's kind of like liquid versions of snow, basically, if you even know what that is.
I know what snow is. Liquid versions of snow. Okay, I think I got an idea what that is, yes. It's the stuff that's like it's in my pool.
Yeah, like that. Right, but I'm not talking about the snow that keeps Vegas power 24/7 either.
Oh, if it were to snow here, why is there ladies, why is there a bra out here? That's so weird. Anyway,
that's got to be the best thing for a podcast. Thank you.
No problem. If it were to snow here, I'm pretty sure North Las Vegas would be out snorting their driveways.
Oh, I'm pretty sure, like, oh my God, 10 o'clock news, everybody dead.
Nice.
No, I did get a chance to watch you on Burn Notice with Amazing Jonathan. Speaking of, how was that wedding?
That wedding was probably the ultimate best wedding I've ever been in my entire life. There was no rehearsals for it. There was no dinner. There was none of that traditional stuff. We got there at 2 o'clock. And we were told, wing it. And Jonathan specifically said to me, he says, if you wouldn't mind taking some selfies and you can drink your Slurpee on the way down the aisle and you guys can get lost or do whatever you want. I'm like, okay. And then the questions, everything was like, Gallagher was the one that married them. So the questions were like, do you take this woman for better or for worse? And Jonathan's response was, I'll take better. then the response, sickness and health, he said, oh, definitely health. And you know that Jonathan's very ill right now. So
unfortunately,
when Gallagher said, for the rest of your life, he said, no problem, that's easy. Give me another one.
Dude, he's funny.
When Gallagher asked if anybody here should have a reason why these two should not be wed, speak now or forever hold your peace, the entire chapel put their hands up in the air. Everybody. Not a single person didn't put their... Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Now back. Yep.
Okay, everybody, so I'm having sound issues, so whenever he flips me off, that's his cue to say, hey, your sound's off. So was it a gathering of, how you would call it, social degenerates? Hey, can you hear me?
Oh, I could hear you. I just wanted to flip you off that time.
Okay, smart ass. So it was a gathering of social degenerates, I would imagine.
It was all show people. You know, Copperfield was there, Vince Neil, Carrot Top, like the usual group, and then a bunch of other entertainers. Actually, reception was awesome because the DJ just played background music and there was no bird dance and all that chronic crap. He just played background music. And they had actually entertainers. They had magicians and jugglers and contortionists. And it was just very entertaining. The food was unreal. You had three bouncy castles. One you had to go through to get into the reception. You know,
it's
it was
awesome.
A candy bar. It was just such a classy, awesome event. And he didn't do it the traditional way. He did it in such a way that everybody knew that he's madly in love with this woman, and to take all the traditional values of what a wedding is and threw them out the window. So it was really great. I really enjoyed it. Definitely one of my favorites.
I remember my cousin's wedding years ago. He is a huge fan of Star Wars, and his wedding march was the Imperial Death March. That was pretty funny.
Oh, yeah.
And believe it or not, him and his wife are still together.
Well, yeah, it's not about the wedding that keeps people together. It's about the love for each other, right?
Oh, definitely. Definitely. Yeah. Now, I know that... When
I got married back in 1994, and I spent 20 grand on the wedding. And I'm divorced now. That didn't work at all. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I could see that. It doesn't matter how much money you're putting into the wedding.
Absolutely.
Now, I know that you're a dual citizen now, right?
Yep. Proud.
When did you become a dual citizen? It wasn't too long ago, was it?
No, it was just March when I went to the actual ceremony. But I started the process in 1999.
And you hail from, was it Alberta? I can't remember.
Yeah, Calgary, Alberta, Canada. Yeah.
Man, there's quite a few great hypnotists from Canada. I know you've got yourself, Savard, the old Ravine. Just get quite a few talent coming from there.
Oh, yeah. There's a ton load of hypnotists that are coming out of Canada right now. I think because Canadians are really smart, and we realize it's an easy way to make great money. You know?
And you guys are easy to make fun of. I love anytime I have Canadian tourists, they're so easy because they tell us sorry for everything.
I got a T-shirt, actually, that says sorry on it. I almost wore that one today, too.
Yeah, that's how Canadians are, and I always have my stupid joke. I'll ask Canadians when they're in my timeshare booth. I'll ask them, I'm like, "Hey, do you know how they came up with the name Canada?" And they try to tell me Canada and all that. I'm like, "No. I heard they took a hat, put a bunch of letters in it.
C-A-D-A-N-A. Yeah.
You're like the only Canadian. Well, you're in show business, so you're gonna obviously hear that. But most Canadians look at me like I'm an idiot. I'm like, "No, I'm pulling your leg." No. If you could give my audience a brief background of how you came to where you're at now, so I know you're doing really well.
Well, thank you. Actually, I started hypnosis. I started reading about it when I was very, very young. My mentor was a guy named Peter Ravine, who toured Canada extensively, and to this day, he still holds records that have been untouched by anybody up there. But I never got a chance to meet him actually, or see his show until I was into the game for about 3 months, and I waited for about 3 hours after a show to meet the guy, and when I met him, he gave me a big piece of advice. He said, son, if you ever want to make any real money at this game, don't use the F word, of course, which everybody started erupting laughing because I've been basically dropping F-bombs my entire career so far. But I toured extensively for about 10 years after doing my first show, May 7th, 1994, and I got lucky enough to work in Mississippi, a house gig for a company called Park Place Entertainment. And to this day, I'm still the longest running show period on the Gulf Coast, because it's a small population base, only about 125,000 people. And I outlasted Cirque du Soleil, Blue Man Group, Lord of the Dance, and a few other shows combined. And the reason why is because once you've seen that show, you've seen the show. You don't have to go back again. Where my show, I changed it every night. So I get the locals coming out 5-6 nights a week to come see the same, you know, see my show. And it was quite the honor. I played out there for 4 years, and then that company tried to move me into Las Vegas. Katrina came and took away the casino that I played at. Literally,
that's a big hit.
Yeah. Like literally, the 1,500-foot barge was lifted up off its moorings, put in the middle of the highway. When they imploded, I could see the stage. I'm like, that's where I used to boom stand, and that was sort of sad. But anyways, I got a gig at the Stardust back in 2003. and only played about 8 months of that one before I got moved over to the Paris Casino, and I've been there since, and I've been at the Paris now for over 9 years, so it's been a good time.
You know, it's funny, I don't know if I told you this, I was actually in, I was meeting a customer, I was going to give him some vouchers for a boat trip, or I think it was a helicopter or something, and went to a bar, and he's like, hey, let me get a couple beers, we're drinking, I think he's from Vegas, somehow we're talking about Vegas, and I was like, yeah, I got a friend there, Anthony Cool. Can you hear me?
No. No.
Can you hear me?
Now I got you back. Okay, I have a friend there named Anthony Cools, and then I lost you.
Okay, so what happened? This guy told me he went to a stage show. He was on the stage. He said he wasn't too receptive. I don't know if you sent him back, but he said one of his friends, some girl, you had her, I think the cops were after her, took a bunch of weed, all wrapped up, started shoving it up inside her. When he said that, I was like, can you hear me?
You got to spend the $6 and get yourself a new mic cable, dude.
I think that might be it.
I don't do that bit. I don't think that was me. That may have been Savard. That wasn't me. I don't remember doing that.
Okay, so two dirty stage comics. But yeah, I'm pretty sure I have to spend a couple dollars, get the new mic cable. Or when I got my first podcast mixer, I should have spent more than $80 wishing it was going to last more than a year.
There you go.
I'm pretty sure that wasn't Dustin. The one thing I love about your show is, especially from the get-go, you got an awesome pre-talk. Pre-talk is king. You got to have a good pre-talk, and I like how you weed out the drunks right away. You do a little ear bit, do all that.
Yep.
What would you suggest to people that want to get into stage hypnosis about how to structure a good pre-talk?
Well, first thing is be original. I mean, you're not going to be successful if you're mimicking other guys. It's as simple as that. If you're taking bits from other guys, it's not going to work. I mean, people will always look at you and say, oh, yeah, I saw that guy do that bit. And it's just like comedians, you know, you got to stay original. You got to do your own material. And the way I develop my material is going on the road. I would sit afterwards with the staff at the bar that I just performed at and have a couple of drinks, and usually I hypnotize one or two staff. I just let everybody chime in. Hey, let's try this. Hey, let's try this. Hey, let's try this. You know, that's where the Burn and Ring of Fire originated from, was sitting in a bar at 3 o'clock in the morning, and, you know, somebody said, hey, make his ass itch. And I said, that'd be pretty funny. And then I said, you know, it'd be funny. You can only itch it with the floor. Itch it with the floor. And I thought, you know, that would go well with Johnny Cash's Burn and Ring of Fire. And that's how that bit came to be. And that was and that's been a signature staple bit in my show for, you know, 15 years now. But I would say that the number one key to being successful in this business is stay original. Be your own thing. And if you can not learn from somebody else, that's the best. I mean, I had no mentors. I'd never seen a hypnosis show before. I was probably about 18 or 19 years old, but I'd already been studying it for about 4 years. And this is pre-internet, you know, back in the days when you actually had to go and get a book and read the book. And yeah, a book, really weird. And unfortunately, most of the stuff that's available to a 15-year-old kid back, I won't say how old I am, but back before the internet is, you know, how to hypnotize your friends at parties, which is completely useless material. But it was still a long education, and if it's going to take you some time. You're going to have a lot of time to develop the way you want to have it, you know. And my very first show, I still have it on VHS. It was a cruder, not a smooth version of what I'm doing still today. You know, I knew I wanted to do an adult show, but I walked up on stage, you know, with a cigarette in one hand and a beer in the other hand, you know, and a mic stand saying, you know what, let's hypnotize some people over here. You know, and I expected about 100 people to show up for my very first show, and 550 people showed up for my very first show.
Oh, damn.
And then I spawned a bunch of other hypnotists, you know, that came in after me. I could think of probably a dozen guys that have come in under my coattails and done a lot of my material, and they're not nearly as successful, and they never will be.
You know, the one thing that okay, hopefully you can hear me.
Okay, say something again? No.
There, hopefully you can hear me.
Got you now.
Okay, I just have to hold my hand here, stuck like glue. I was going to say, living out here on the islands, on Oahu, there's, I think, three or four hypnotists, and they are, for the most part, all of them are really, really cocky. I've heard of them going to other people's shows, trying to poach customers. I've seen that, I think, in the hypnosis world, you get a lot of people that are really cocky and like to talk shit about everybody. That's one of the worst things that you can do, and I'm pretty sure you're not going to make a name for yourself in Vegas if you're trying to talk down about everybody.
The three remaining shows here, Kevin Lapine, Mark Savard, and myself, all three of us are friends, and we actually go out and have lunch together, and we will remain friends no matter what. There's more than enough work out there, and instead of trying to look behind you at what your friends are doing, your competition is doing, start looking ahead and start realizing what you can do to make your show better. I've never shit-talked anybody, and I never will shit-talk anybody, because I don't care. At the end of the day, I don't care what they're saying and what they're doing. It's what I'm doing that matters. I need to look forward. I need to make something happen for myself. So why worry about what other people are saying or what other people are doing? It's ridiculous.
Oh, true, true. There's one thing. I don't know if you can comment on this. I heard of a story years ago. I don't know if it was about you. Did you ever have an incident with some guy on a hobby horse?
A hop? No.
Okay, there's I heard of a story. I can't remember what it was. I think hypnotist hypnotized somebody to think he was on a horse, and apparently the dude, not having good safety protocols, the dude left off the stage. I think he was on some kind of horse. I remember when I first heard about you, I think, 9 years ago, that might have been you.
No, not me.
No.
I've been tackled by an undercover narcotics officer for giving him an imaginary joint, and handcuffed up on stage, and he cut my head open and all that kind of stuff. And my hand, I was bleeding pretty profusely. That was when we first opened up at the Paris.
I thought you said he cut your head. Okay, so he cut your hand with a...
Actually, he forced me into the... I had a carpeted stage at the time, and he forced me into the carpet, and he rug burned the top of my head to the point where it was bleeding and all that. All I had to do was say the words "wide awake" to him. That's all I had to do.
But you didn't want to. It's a great show.
I didn't want to. And he put me down so hard, and the audience literally stood up and one of these things, right? And at the end of the show, I got a Band-Aid on, and I just finished up the show. And at the end of the show, he came over and he says, "Man, I'm so sorry. I have no idea. Like me, I'm a narcotics officer, and I'm trained to do this." I'm like, "Dude, really, it's not a deal." He says, "Oh, man, I feel so bad. You're not going to sue me or anything like that." I'm like, "Dude, let me tell you what's going to happen. This story is going to get picked up by every radio station and television station in Las Vegas." He says, "Oh, my God, I'm so sorry. Is there any way you can stop it?" I'm like, "Stop it.
No, I want it. I want it to happen.
I'm the one that's spreading the news out there. I'm the one that's distributing the DVDs." He started laughing. And sure enough, that night, on all the TV stations, "Local hypnotist arrested" was the tag. And that's all they said, and until you tuned into the story, and then you found out that it was it was part of the show. The undercover cover officer, tackled me because I gave him an imaginary joint. But I got the word out there. I got probably $50,000 worth of advertising out of that bad boy. I'm like, free advertising. That's one situation where I got hurt up on stage. I've had people knock out teeth with their chairs when they're auditioning for a porno with it.
With the webcam bit.
Yeah, but I'd say that's pretty much the only thing that's anybody. I've never been. Nobody's ever fallen off the stage like that. I've had a guy's false leg fall off the stage one time. He was having an orgasm and he's whipping his legs around so profusely in front of him that the leg actually flung off his body and off the stage and landed in the lady's lap in the front row. That was interesting. I
bet people busted out laughing.
Everybody except my stage assistant, poor Quinn, who had to go back and fetch the leg. She wasn't too happy about that because, the guy couldn't stand up with one leg. But
wow.
Yeah, but no, I had never done a hobby horse bit or anything like that, so that must have been somebody else.
Okay, I'd have to, look back my memory banks years ago through all my drinking and partying, and I probably won't remember it.
We could be friends. We are going to be friends. I'll tell you that right now.
Yeah, you might be able to drink more than me, considering you're in Vegas.
Nothing like a scotch and a cigar. Nothing like it.
And I like that whiskey hat. Speaking of whiskey, have you ever heard of the it's not a ginger ale. It comes from Detroit, Verner's.
Do they make a root beer too?
No, no. If you get a chance, I know there's a casino. I think it's in Las Vegas. I think it's called the D.
Mm-hmm.
Go there, get a thing of Verner's. Ask them for Verner's. It's the best. I think it's the original ginger ale. That and whiskey together, it almost has like a vanilla taste to it.
Really? I'll have to give it a shot.
Very good and very deadly. Give it a couple shots.
Nice.
I was going to ask you, what if somebody wanted to get into stage hypnosis, if they wanted to learn from some people, who would you recommend?
Well, like I said, I'm not a big fan of learning from anybody because I believe that if you learn from somebody, you're going to learn that person's mistakes. And I also believe in a firm fact that those who can't do, teach. But that being said, I know that Mark offers a fantastic course, and I also know that Kevin Lapine offers a fantastic course. I think Jim Wand at one point in time was offering some really great hypnosis courses. And other than that, I'll be very honest with you, I'm not really in that clique of people that are in doing all that kind of stuff. Like I stay away from all that stuff. I don't like the drama and the crap and all that stuff and stuff. So I just do my own thing. But I've heard from other people that those are the three people to learn from.
What are you talking about? Drama inside the hypnosis community? Never. Mm-hmm. Yeah, too much drama.
Well, yeah. I mean, there's the hypnosis page, and I see people on there all the time. And Richard Barker runs that page, and I know that at one point in time, they were just bickering, and he just started taking all the negative people and just kicking them all out. And now when I visit the page, it's a very strong community of people that are supporting each other. And I'm one of those people that firmly believes that you can lift yourself up by lifting everybody else up around you as opposed to knocking them down.
Oh, yeah. That's if you're in a good mood. I notice that when I'm doing sales, if I seem desperate trying to get money, it ruins it. But if I'm in a good mood, other people are in a good mood, and people are just generally in a good mood. And with me, if I put somebody in a bad mood on vacation, they're going to remember me for a long time, not in a good way.
Yeah, of course, absolutely. Well, you know, positive thinking, positive results.
Yeah, so, God, what's the temperature over there? It's got to be...
It's about 110 here today.
Holy smoke. I don't see how you guys deal with that.
Well, the thing is, I'm from Canada originally, and where I was from, we'd have 10 months of bearable weather, and then in usually January or February, we have 2 months of just the crappiest, coldest weather where it was just too miserable to go outside. And I tell people that Vegas is very similar to Canada in that way. 10 months of fantastic weather, then 2 months of just really crappy weather where it's just too unbearable to go outside. And that's basically the season that we're entering right now. You know, we'll have 2 months of solid 120s during the day and dipping down to the cools of 95 every night. But the other 10 months of the year is definitely well worth it. This is our off season right now. You know, nobody's coming here. This is a slow time of year.
Well, except for all of us hypnotists, because it's cheap. We're going to go there in July and freaking burn up.
There you go.
Now, I'm wondering if you're going to try making it to the Hypno Thoughts Live, or if you I know you got a really busy schedule.
Yeah, I don't, like I said, I don't really participate in that kind of stuff. Like, I'm not worried about what other people are doing. I'm worried about what I'm doing and keeping my head facing forward. So I don't really do that kind of thing. I know I get a lot of hypnotists every year that come in and they sit in my showroom during the show and there's notepads and taking notes and things like that. I'm like, that's not how you learn. You got to learn by creating something for yourself. You know, you got to make something happen for yourself. So I don't really participate in that. Kevin does. I know he's been invited to talk this time. I don't know if he's going to do it or not, but I know he's been invited to go in there.
You know, one thing that Jim Wan actually said recently, that you bring up a good point. It's like if you want to learn stage hypnosis and you go to a stage hypnosis show, get your butt up on stage. That way you actually experience it. The funny thing is, the first person that hypnotized me was Kevin Lapine. We were both from Michigan, hypnotized me at Cliff Bell's, a speakeasy, years ago.
And Kevin's a good guy.
I like him. He's he borders on the raunchy. He kind of he doesn't have the same kind of shtick you have. He kind of borders back and forth, but the one thing I like that he said, that he wouldn't do anything that he wouldn't want his mom to do or his sister or something like that. I remember in that same podcast he was talking about, we're talking about you. God, what did he say? Remember, it was all good. It said something about, he's like, oh, that's his shtick. It works good because everybody going to your show, they know what your shtick is.
Yeah, yeah.
And you pretty much, I think you have ample warnings like, yeah, you might want to turn around.
Oh, yeah, you're warned 10 times before you walk in the door. And for those people that do get offended at my show, I tell them two different things. I say, first off, I'm sorry that your imagination is so dirty. Because, like, for example, when people are auditioning for a porno with the chair, they're not really auditioning for a porno with the chair. Their clothing is on. Nothing's entering any orifices. Nothing's being exposed. It's not X-rated. There's no nudity involved. They're just making a motion. And I promise you this. If you go to any nightclub in Las Vegas and you watch that dance floor, you're going to see 1,000 times dirtier things than you're going to see in my show. 1,000 times dirtier. So I say, first off, I'm sorry your imagination is so dirty. And second of all, you know what? I think that you really need to learn how to read, because you've been warned with every piece of advertising that's out there that this is an adult show. And then you're physically warned again with the sign at the front. And then you're physically told by the sound assistant up on stage what you're getting into. So if you've been offended by the show, Jesus, go crawl under a rock, because I don't want you in my gene pool.
Exactly. Now, the one thing is, when I was in Vegas, it's crazy how good your advertising is. Your face is everywhere. Cabs everywhere.
Well, that's part of the shtick, too, is, you know, you need to be able to put out some money in advertising. And when I was here in 03, and I got the opportunity to work at the Stardust, and I got paid, it wasn't a three-wall or a four-wall deal, I got to see how things in Las Vegas work. And I'm a firm believer that Las Vegas is a four-day town, Thursday through Sunday and Sunday through Thursday. And you need to make your show survive for 4 days. If you can make your show survive for 4 days, you'll survive for all time, because the town rotates all the time. Every Thursday and every Sunday is a switchover time. So those days, like, for example, when I opened up at the Paris, I didn't do a red carpet event. I didn't do a grand opening event. I didn't do any of that kind of stuff. That stuff is for your ego and your ego only, because 4 days later, nobody's going to remember it. All of those people that are in town for that are now home. And 4 days later, you have a whole bunch of fresh people. So I started advertising literally the day before I opened up, and I hit it hard. And, you know, I had billboards and billboard trucks and every magazine, and I hit it hard. And it worked. People came in and said, oh, what's this? Let's go check it out. And then over time, I started getting reviews and things like that, and I established myself. I also was smart enough to eliminate the middleman. When I opened up at the Paris, instead of having a print company come in and do all my printing for me, I opened up a print company, and I printed all my own stuff. So I eliminated all of that profit margin. And then having a billboard truck, instead of hiring somebody in a truck to drive up and down with my ads every day, I just got my own billboard trucks, printed them myself, hired my own drivers, just formed a new company. And that company's still operating now. We have 8 trucks in that company. But eliminating the middleman really increased my profit margin.
That's ingenious. And quick question about whole four-wall, two-wall. I've heard the term. I know on one of the groups, on Richard Barker's group, there was somebody that was accusing some of the hypnotists in Vegas of being four-wall, two-wall. Is that basically, I think their term was play-to-pay or something, or pay-to-play, whatever it is.
I know what hypnotists are referring to. Yeah, and he seems to believe that anybody can come and get a show in Las Vegas because you do pay-to-play. And that's true, and that's been true since 1994, basically. Every show in town, including Celine Dion and Elton John and all of the big names playing over at Caesars, every show in town rents the space from the casino. It's either done on a percentage base, which would make it a three-wall deal, or it's done on a pure rent base, which would make it a four-wall deal, and then you're told, go be successful. The casinos are now out of the entertainment business. They are worrying about gambling revenue, and if they can get a show in there that's going to guarantee them a rent check every week, that's what they want to have in here. But that being said, you still can't get a room. There are no rooms in Las Vegas. Nobody's given up this stuff. My room at Paris, 5 shows a week pitch the Paris casino to take over my room. 5 shows a week pitch it. And, of course, the Paris says, no, we're very happy with Anthony Cools, and we got a contract with Anthony Cools. And that being said, there's no other casinos to play. Like, I'll even say something egotistical here and say that I'm the only hypnotist playing a casino on the Strip.
That's a very good title to have it.
Mark Savard is playing the Strip, but he's playing in the Miracle Mile. He's playing in the Mall. And Kevin Lapine is playing Hooters off the Strip. And if those guys, if they had an opportunity to move to the Venetian or the Palazzo, they would jump on it in a heartbeat, you know, because your traffic goes up through the roof. Location is everything for successful shows here. Back in 2005, I got an opportunity to go play over the Excalibur, and I was doing consistently 270 to 300 seats a night at the Paris. And at that time, I thought, well, this is great. I got to go down the street and get a 90-10 split as opposed to the percentage that I'm playing now. So I've moved my show down to the Excalibur, and my numbers dropped from 270 people a night to 90 people a night overnight. Same
Wow.
Same advertising, same commission structures, same everything. It was all done the same way. So I immediately made plans to get back to the Paris as quickly as possible. 8 months later, I was back at the Paris. And myself and Gordy Brown are the only two acts in all of Las Vegas history that have left a casino and gone back. But they'll tell you, I mean, that's a block apart, a block, one city block apart, Excalibur and the Paris. And location is everything to be successful. And for all those hypnotists who just think they can pay to play to get down here, it's not that easy.
Yeah, it doesn't seem that easy. Vegas, it's a money town.
Yeah, it is. But the thing is, every decent location has got a long-term contract showing it already.
Hey, be careful. Don't step on that cord.
Okay, I'll be careful. I'll move it right now.
Okay. Hey, little one, munching, don't step on the cord.
I'm not that little. I'm 6 feet tall.
Yeah, I was like, Munchkin, walk me out of my computer.
You can call me Munchkin if you want to, though.
You're actually pretty tall. From, or maybe it's just you're larger than life advertisements.
Yeah, maybe.
making yourself look like who's that one communist leader? Was it Mao Zedong? I think he'd basically make himself look 20,000 times smaller than all his little minions.
Great, being compared to communist leaders, that's awesome. I tip my hat to you, buddy.
Now, I was wondering, so we're going to get going pretty soon. Do you have your own version of the Aristocrats? I always love hearing that joke.
Oh, my God. I could probably write one on the fly if you really wanted to.
Yeah, I would love to. I've done my own version a long time ago. I'm definitely not going to do it with my nieces in the background because they will be going to therapy for years.
Okay. So you want me to end the show by telling you the Aristocrats joke?
Oh, real quick, before we do that, what's your website?
Oh, anthonycools.com. But I think the websites are sort of becoming passe these days. Everybody's following the social medias, you know.
Yep.
So Instagram at Anthony Cools. The Facebook page is Anthony Cools, and the Twitter handle is at HypnoCools, HypnoCools. And that's because some other bastard took Anthony Cools.
And if you want, you can give people out your street address so you can have people stalking you.
Sure, no.
Bad idea.
Bad idea. And I'm starting a new company up right away. It's going to be called the Drone Experts, and I'm getting into drone flying. So that's the newest thing that I'll be doing during the days. You know, because
what are you getting into?
Drones, drone flying. You know, it's
advertisements.
No, not advertisements. It has nothing to do with hypnosis. It's actually on a commercial grade, flying octocopters, hexacopters, and quadcopters carrying cameras for film, for videography, and aerial photography.
And sneaking inside of bedroom windows?
Well, this thing's, you know, 5 feet in diameter, makes a sound like a jet engine taking off, so it's a little bit difficult to do that. But
Can't just sneak up on somebody's window with a big, whoa, 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 big loud noise popping out?
No.
So everybody, Anthony's going to finish off with the Aristocrats joke, and so far through the podcast, my little couple of cuss words have been cussed or bleeped out. I'll do that post-edit. This joke is pretty dirty, so it's really dirty, so if you want to turn away now, you might want to do that. If you want to fly away with your off-the-cuff Aristocrats.
Okay. And here we go. So this guy walks into his agent's office, and his agent's sitting behind the desk. He's got a big cigar. He says, "How can I help you?" And the guy looks at him and says, "Well, I got this great new act for it. You're going to love it. It's a family bit." Agent sits back and puts his feet up. He says, "Well, tell me about it. I'm always looking for a new family bit." He says, "Well, this is fantastic. It's about a young man and his beautiful wife. and their young daughter and son. Agent goes, I'm listening. Please continue on. He says, well, it starts off. Let me just tell you about the show. It starts off, you know, the set is set with this beautiful purple mood lighting, and the son walks out in the middle of the stage and just takes a great big shit. Agent goes, a great big shit. Then the daughter comes out, starts licking the shit. And, of course, that causes her to vomit. And now we got a little bit of vomit, a little bit of shit up on stage. Then mom and dad come out, and they start slip-sliding up and down in the shit and the vomit. And they form a little slide almost like that, and they start running and playing. And, of course, there's classical music playing in the background because it just wouldn't make sense without it. Then the mom decides she gets a little bit frisky and pulls down her son's pants and starts blowing him, jerking him off. And the dad grabs the daughter, and instead of fucking her, he starts fisting her. And I mean fisting her. Not just a little bit, but he gets his hand right up there. He starts working her like a puppet, flopping around. And, of course, while the son's getting blown by his mom, he starts laughing. And, of course, this brings the audience to tears. This is one of the highlights of the bit. Next thing you know, dad decides he's getting a little horny too, so he gets rid of the daughter, throws her up into the wall. She's pretty much unconscious at this point in time. He starts fucking mom. Now, the son wants to get in on the action too, so he gets up behind mom and he starts finger fucking her too, right? Now, mom's on her period. We don't know this. It's a surprise! So the blood starts coming out, and the daughter comes out, and she's licking the blood off the mom while the son's fucking her mom up the ass while she's giving dad a ride on his ding-dong. And then next thing you know, this is the big surprise. This is the big kicker, okay? All four family members simultaneously stick their fingers down their throats and vomit on the audience. Curtain down! The agent sort of got this stunned look on his face, like, wow. And he says to the guy, what do you call this act? And the guy says, the Aristocrats.
Oh, my God. Oh, yeah. I think I'm going to have two versions of this.
You asked for it. You asked
I know, I know. Yeah. I asked for it. I had my own version. I said it once, and people looked at me like, oh, my God, you're a horrible, horrible human being.
But the idea that joke is a joke between comedians. That's not really something that you tell the public. That's a joke that you tell other comedians. And the idea is, of course, to gross out the other comedians, to get them going, oh, my God, I never thought of that, right?
Have you ever seen the movie The Aristocrats?
Yeah, Penn Jillette's actually a friend of mine, and I actually got to go over to his house with the amazing Jonathan, and we pre-screened it before it went into the out to the public, and I was dying laughing. It was so funny, just so well done.
I like Sarah Silverman's joke where she's like, "Oh, had her." I think she said, I had my brother. Oh, he has Down syndrome, by the way. Like not nonchalant. I'm like, "Oh, what? What a bunch of scumbags." So I think my audience viewership might have gone, beep, boom, might have shot it down. But either way, finally I had a chance where I could actually be like, hey, I can, because my humor, I have to be really careful with my humor. Because the job I do, you know those timeshare people up and down the street. You know they call us OPCs.
I don't know what that is.
It's outside public concierge. Here, give me a second. Hey, go like this.
Earmuffs. Somebody that actually OPC. Says earmuffs. Wow.
Yeah. No. OPC, people think it stands for outside public concierge. It actually, in my opinion, it's overpaid cunt.
No, I don't sell timeshares. My tickets aren't available through timeshares.
Oh, I thought somebody said they were. Why aren't they available via timeshare?
I don't need to sell them via timeshare.
Oh, you've already got your got your drones.
I don't like to heavily discount my tickets. I just don't like to do that.
How much is a ticket to your show again?
General admissions $42.95, VIP is $54.95, and then ultra VIP I think is $75 or something like that.
That's not bad for a kick-ass show.
Thanks, bud. I appreciate that. Thank you.
You know, like I said, finally got a chance to get a little dirty, and like long story short, I was going to say about doing the OPC work, timeshare work. Good thing I don't work actually in the resort. I'd have been fired. The way I joke with people, they'd have been like, yeah, back of the line. So my joke's kind of border, but especially when I can get on a podcast with somebody that can be jovial. You got awesome. any other messages, qualms, or things you want to blurt out?
Follow my social medias, follow the Instagram, because it's got a whole bunch of the new drone stuff out there, and if you're a budding hypnotist, be original, stay original, and pay your dues. You know, I mean, if you're gonna flop around for a little while, guess what? You need to do that, because you need to start somewhere. Don't take anybody else's bits to make a fast start, because it's not going to work.
And one last question. So I'm guessing you always have cock on your chest on Wednesday, right?
No, actually, I wore this specifically for you. Just
perfect.
For you. Yes, just for
perfect.
You.
Hey, thank you. It's been a great talk, and hopefully I will see you in July when we're out there sweltering.
I'll be here.
You're always there. Let me know when you're going to be coming out to Hawaii, and you should get, about a week off vacation?
Yeah, I'll be taking a week off in December.
Well, hell, hit here and see what a beach is. You know, water, beach, that sand stuff.
I don't know what that is. I got water. Look, I got water. See? Where's water?
But it doesn't taste like a whale let a big load in it, does it? It's not that salty kind, right?
Yeah, it's salty. It's saline.
It's got a little bit of saline.